students, welcome back. In this violin lesson, I'm going to teach you a beautiful melody, the Andante by Edward Elgar. And this video is part of my free beginner course. If you have no idea what this is about, then you can watch all the previous lessons in the YouTube playlist right here. And if you're wondering who I am, I am Zlata, I live in Holland. I'm a professional violinist turned stay-at-home mom, and now I'm sharing my art and skills online. Maybe you'd like to share a little bit about yourself and your violin story up until now in the comments below. Now here's the piece that I'm going to teach you today. The sheet music for free if you sign up at violinlessonsforfree.com. You'll not only get the free sheet music, but I also provide a sound slice in which you can play the piano accompaniment, my part, my part with piano accompaniment at any speed, and you can even loop them, you can practice with metronome, so I really recommend using that tool to practice this. Well, now I'm going to give you a couple of pointers for your practice. First of all, let's look at the rhythm of this piece. It's in a 3/4 measure, and I'll dissect the rhythm in a sec, because the rhythmical pattern is quite the same throughout the piece. Now, what you will see is a quarter note with the dots, an eighth note, and those are slurred all the time, and then two eighth notes. Now, let's take a look at my famous, I don't know if it's famous, rhythm pie. And what you will see here, we have a 3/4 measure, and that is also 6 eighth notes, okay? So if we have that first note, we have a quarter note, that's usually 2 eighth notes, but there's a dot, so it's 3 eighth notes, okay? So we have 1.5 count, and then we have the eighth notes, okay? So the quarter note with the dot behind it takes just as much time as the 3 following eighth notes, all right? For your bow, with the slurs, it means that you actually play a half note, so 4 eighth notes, or 2 quarter notes, and then a quarter note, okay? Because actually, if you don't play the notes, but you just play what you would play with your bow, it's 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And this means that you have to do catch-up bowing. So if you don't change anything, and you'll go, then you'll out of bow. So you have to catch up. And if you do that without any further tricks, so to say, but we don't want this piece to sound like this. So what you must do is to play that quarter note, so to say, so the last eighth notes of the bar that are slurred, so you actually with your bow you're playing a quarter note, is that you play them a little bit lighter, so you move the weight from your bow, and that will compensate for that you have a higher bow speed, because you must do 2 counts on the down bow and then 1 count on the up bow. That makes your up bow louder, and we must make it softer again by using less weight. And I went into weight and pressure in the previous lesson, so I won't repeat everything about it. So the rhythm here is all the time 1, 2, and 3, and 1, 2, and 3, and that is actually the rhythm. But you might first want to practice the bowing of this piece, so the catch up bowing. 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. And of course we're not playing whole bow eventually, but it's good to practice it in this way. So that is the rhythm. Let's play through the piece and just see what happens here. And you see that I don't use whole bow and I don't get really back all the time. So, but you must catch up just a little bit. Now, we get to the second line and there we have a crescendo to forte. And you can choose for a fourth finger or an open E string in the last note of that bar in which we have the crescendo. The advantage of an open E string is that you get a natural crescendo because it sounds louder. That you are already on the E string for the next bar. And the advantage of a fourth finger is that you don't have a string crossing within that slur. You choose, okay? Now, the crescendo we have already covered dynamics and how to do them in the previous lesson, so I won't go into the how-to, but we do have a crescendo right here, and I use not so much bow in the beginning of the piece, but you can start using more bow in the forte. And you see that 2 bars later, you already suddenly have to be in piano, but I like to make a quite natural transition there. So you really don't need to do a subito piano, I think, at least. And did you see how that fourth finger created actually a natural decrescendo here? So that fourth finger, you might want to avoid it. A lot of people avoid fourth fingers, but here you really want to make use of it. So maybe you want to practice putting down that fourth finger in one go. How you practice that? Now how you practice that is going from 3 to 4, from 2 to 4, from 1 to 4, and from 0 to 4. Alright, so that's a practice for putting down the fourth finger in one go, which you have to do right here. Actually, really useful also for other stuff, by the way. So let's continue there at the piano. Crescendo. Because we have to retake our bows here to, because we're ending up down bow and we have to continue down bow and we don't have space for that on one bow stroke. You want to retake the bow, which is really natural here as we start a new part of the piece actually. And usually you take some breath here, and if you're playing together with a real pianist, then it's quite common that he or she waits for you or that you decide how you time this. But what you want to do is maybe make that G a little bit shorter, and then you have time to retake your bow and then continue right there. And here I like to choose a fourth finger just because I don't want such a long note on the open E string. You can perfectly do it, just to make the note not too loud and shrill. But yeah, I think it's beautiful to do a fourth finger there. It also makes the decrescendo a little bit easier. And here we are back to the main theme, so to say. And here it's written that you play an open E string there. I like to make this crescendo a little bit more intense than the one in line 2. You can choose to do a fourth finger for the first one and then an open string here. But if you want to make them consistent, then feel free to do so, of course. Let's continue on that crescendo. And there we have a so-called forzando. This is sort of an accent. Considering the atmosphere of the piece, I don't want to make a forzando like that. I just want to use a little bit more bow speed and a vibrato accent to do that. So I don't want to make a full forzando there. And here we have the fifth grip that we had in La Vie en Rose as well. So make sure for that your finger is on the C on the A string as well as the F on the D string, okay? And you can switch the strings with your arm or your wrist or your finger, whatever is convenient for you. But just that you know that it's there, I start on the beginning of the last line. Back to piano. And here you can also make a choice between a fourth finger or an open D string. The advantage of the open D string is that you're already on the D string for that E and that you don't have to switch just for that E. And the advantage of a fourth finger is that you don't have a string crossing in the slur. So just see what you like better, alright? And this note is 5 counts, so 1, 2, 3, 1, 2. And you can even make it longer if that's what you think is tasteful right here. Well, that's it. I hope this all is useful and that you really enjoy playing this melody. I think it's a very beautiful melody. And I also hope that you stay my student by subscribing to my channel. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye. See you next lesson.